be automatic?
Yeah, you don't need to. Is it on? Yes, it's on.
Oh, nice.
And you have the laser pointer there as well, if you need to show something. Oh, on top.
Great.
What's the problem with
little, it's not very clear. If you look from the back, it's a little fuzzy. This is the.
I can run a second projector, but with the focus, I cannot do nothing.
Yes. Okay. This is the best.
It's old
best
projector. Can I run the second projector?
I don't think we need the second. Right, but the second one is more crisp?
I think it's better because it's smaller, but sharper.
No. Not sure it will help because from far away.
We can.
We can try. Hopefully, it doesn't break anything.
Welcome to
about the Ceph integration we did in OpenStack. So we'll talk about the short introduction to oVirt and all the components that we learned. Then we'll look at the difference between traditional open storage and the new self-storage, which works completely different. And then we'll talk about a few issues that we have to support self-application and life safety. And the future direction of okay. So, who knows about it?
People cannot hear you.
There is a microphone?
I don't think we have it.
How many people are using oVirt or know about oVirt? Some there should know, I guess. I guess some also know about Ceph on this area. So Ceph is a scalable, highly reliable software-defined storage. oVirt uses only the log storage for now. And to use Ceph, we are using Cinder. Because we had two goals when we wanted to add self-support, we also wanted to to support more storage in the future, and Cinder allows us to access to a lot of storage that we are not using now, but we may be using in the next version. And we support only Ceph backend in Cinder, so we don't care about all the other storage in this version. To talk with Cinder, we're using the OpenStack Java SDK. Cinder support was added by Daniel, who worked on this project. And I will focus mostly on the Ceph integration and less on the Cinder integration, because this project was kind of both Ceph integration and Cinder integration. I will focus on the Ceph side. You can see Mao talk if you want to know about Cinder integration. So, traditional storage. What is the traditional storage? This is a simplified view of oVirt architecture related to storage. We have the engine controlling all the hosts. We have regular hosts like this, and the special host called STM that everybody should know that we're using oVirt. The SPM is the only host that can change the shared storage. For example, if we have block storage, the SPM will go and create volumes on this shared storage, while other hosts will consume the storage. For example, this host will connect to the iStudy server and enable the LVs for the VMs, or do mounts to expose the shell storage to the VMs. But only this host can change stuff. The SPM does a lot of complex stuff, and if the single port of failure, we are working hard to remove it. Hopefully it will be removed in for something. What is block storage in other traditional storage? We support iSCSI or fiber channel. And actually, this is a VG. The volume in over volume in block storage is a VG. inside the VG, we have a special Elvis for metadata, like this one. We have special Elvis for locking, like LBs and misses, and inbox and outbox for messaging. So host can send messages to the SVM. And here we can see regular volume and two other volumes that oVirt uses for to get up over here. So this is basically a block style domain. And what is block volume? On the bottom we have some SCSI devices which we use only via multipath. So in this case we have two passes to the same device. Both of these devices are actually the same remote device. And this is the remote device that we can access via two passes. And we have another remote path field. Both of them belong to VG, which is, this is the storage domain, block storage domain. And inside the block storage domain, you get volumes using LVM. So we have one LV, and on top of the LV, we created Kuka image. And this the last part is what the VM is consuming. The problem with block storage are scale. We cannot create any amount of LVs. Itself become slow. LVM was not designed to create huge amount of LVs. It's complex and hard to manage. We have to do locking to do any change in this in the VG. Only the SVM can do the changes. And we have complex way to roll back changes. There's a problem of timeouts. SCSI timeouts, multipath timeouts. It should be much better on PL7.2. And of course, we have the quality of service for storage operation. We are using the IO class, IO noise to run our operations, but we are not using the CFQ schedulers. Actually, we don't have any quality of service. The CFQ scheduler is much lower. So this is something that we should work on probably. Okay, how do we do sync provisioning? Well, VDSL is not on the data bus, but we provide the device to the VM, and the VM is writing data, and we don't know anything about the written data. So we monitor the watermark, the kiss watermark we are using. And when we find that the disk is too full, we extend it. We extend it via the SVM. So if I'm a host running a VM and the disk becomes too full, I send a message to the SVM. The SVM extends the disk and send back the message that the disk was extended. When operation is finished, we resume the VM because maybe it was too slow and the VM called. And we repeat. So this kind of looks the wrong way to do it, but this is how we do it and kind of works. But of course it's limited. Because we are doing polling, we cannot scale to a huge amount of disks. It becomes costly. It's very complex. It's slow. The VM imports before we put the extended disk. And of course, we depend on the SVM, which is a single point of failure. Okay, let's move to file storage, which is much simpler. We support a lot of shared file systems. File storage domain is just a directory, mounted directory. Here we see a mounted file storage domain. And inside the directory, we have metadata files and images. And file volume is just a couple of files inside the image directory. Here you can see the storage domain, image directory, and image directory. And inside it, we have single volume. This is the data of the volume, list file, and metadata of the volume. And if we have a lot of volumes, we have a lot of files. Sync provisioning is easy. We don't have to do anything. The file just go as needed. Problems, we have overhead of the file system. The VM wants block device, and we put it on the file system, so there is overhead that it's not needed. We have bigger issue of timeouts, because NFS can block for minutes, but it's not accessible. So we run all the storage operation, we don't run them inside VSM, we run them in another process. Currently we are using the I/O process, which does all the I/O for us. For example, to create directory, get a list of files, and stuff like this. And of course, we don't have any way to define quality of service. For example, maybe for locking, provide the better quality of service for some lock, or for other sort of operation, less quality of service, so we don't disturb the VMs. And of course, reliability. It depends on the storage server. If you have one disk with FS and this is gone, your data is one of these. So if you have a smart server that does replication or something, you're good, but if not. Okay, how do we do snapshots? All snapshots, doesn't matter if it's block volume or some volume, are used in the same way. We have a QCAL chain. The VM talks with the top layer, which is using QCAL format, and it has a backing file. The backing file can be raw format or QCAL, depending. And let's see an example. We start with one volume. We create the first snapshot. So we create new volume, and then we switch the VM to the new volume using the reader, if it's live snapshot. And the new volume backing file is the old volume. Okay, so this is, I'll take a snapshot, we can take more snapshots. We can see that we have the problem of scale because it's going to burn out the page soon. So the issue is our performance. For example, if QMO wants to read data, it will try to read it from this volume. And if it's not there, it will try this volume, and this volume, and this volume. So it makes read slower. Writes should not be affected too much, because all the writes are going to the active volume. Again, the problem of scale, because when you have a lot of LVs, you are reaching the maximum number of LVs you should carry on block volume. So people maybe should create more storage domain, so they don't have too many LVs on the same storage domain. And of course, it's difficult to manage. You have to keep the QMO files in sync and the LVs. So it's not a lot of fun. Live merge. We will not talk about it. It's extremely complicated. You can check Adam talk about it. Let's move now to something much more simpler. Ceph storage. Ceph storage works completely different. First, on the host, VDSM is not accessing the storage. It does not know anything about Ceph storage. Only QMO knows about the storage. Only QMO consume the storage via libvd. engine use Cinder to create volumes, to create snapshots, to delete volume snapshots. And Cinder is the Ceph backend in Cinder is doing the regression in Ceph. So one important example, there was no SPM in this diagram because we don't care about SPM in Ceph. We don't use it. So this is nice improvement. Storage domain. There is no storage, Ceph storage domain on the left. On the engine side, we use the Cinder provider which support only Ceph for now, but all the operations are done there using the Cinder APIs. What is Ceph volume? On the host, there is nothing about Ceph volume except piece of XML that we pass to libvirt. We get all the details from the engine that gets it from Cinder. For example, the pool and volume name, the host, the monitors that are serving this this volume, and the authentication details. Sync provisioning, again, nothing to do, Ceph does everything. Snapshots. Nothing on the host, Ceph does snapshots. The host does not know anything about snapshots. You'll send the API to create snapshots. And when we take a snapshot, we have a VM using the Ceph volume. We can take snapshots or another snapshot. There is no dependency between the snapshots. The VM does not know anything about the snapshots. There is no way. There may be a problem of scale on the Ceph side. I don't know anything about how they are doing snapshots, but it's not our problem. So for our side, this is great. Live merge, there's no live merge. We just delete the snapshot on the Cinder and it works. The VM does not know about it. So what are the benefits? Highly available storage, scalable, cost effective. Everything is offloaded to Ceph. And we don't have to manage anything on the host. Or very little. Problem, it's not finished yet. There are some features that are not implemented. And working with Cinder can be tough because Cinder has different ideas about storage compared to oVirt. So we have to fight it sometimes. Ceph may be too complicated for very small deployment. But I'm not sure it's important because if somebody wants it, probably wants to build the planet and scale by the planet. And in a way, Cinder is our new SPM because now we depend on Cinder. So if Cinder is down, we cannot do any source operation. Okay, now let's talk about how do we connect securely to Ceph volumes. The standard way to do Ceph authentication is to create a keyring file and deploy this file on the host. You think the Ceph deploy is doing this for you. But we need something more secure. We don't want to deploy keys like this on all hosts. So what we are using is libvirt secrets. You can register secret in libvirt, and we are using ephemeral secrets and private secrets. It means that the secret is defined on the memory in libvirt, and if libvirt restarts, the secret is gone. So it's never persisted on disk. And private means that you cannot get the secret out from libvirt. Libvirt will give it away to PMO, but nobody can take it out from libvirt. But of course, you cannot define this on libvirt and forget about it, because when libvirt restarts, you lose the secret. So we need to manage this. So what we do is manage now the Ceph authentication key. We can add the Ceph keys to engine. And engine will register the secrets for you on all of them and remove the secrets when they are not needed. To allow this, we added new APIs. There is a register secret API, new video server, and unregister secrets to remove secrets. And engine will register secrets when host is activated, or storage only is activated, or when we reconnect to host. This is the same way that engine is managing the storage connections. So in the same way that we make sure that the host can talk to storage, we also make sure that the host has all the relevant secrets. And when host is put to maintenance or storage domain is put to maintenance, we need to remove all the secrets that should not be there. And also, VDSM will clear secrets when it's stopped or shut down, because it won't leave around secrets that nobody needs them. Okay, live snapshot. Sometimes you want to capture the moment, and to do this, we need consistent snapshots. We don't want to keep snapshots that are not useful to restore later. So to have consistent snapshots, we need to freeze the guest file systems. Then we want to take the snapshot, and then we want to tell the guest file system, and now we know that we have a good snapshot that we can restore later. This of course requires a guest agent, the QMO guest agent. And this is true also for traditional storage, there is no difference. How do we do it with old storage? Engine creates a new disk, and then it takes a snapshot. VDSM we ask libvirt to take the snapshot. We freeze the guest file systems internally inside the snapshot verb of libvirt. And finally, libvirt will switch the VM to the new disk. Now, this will not work for Ceph because this freeze should be here. So we cannot use the old code for this. We have to add to make it different. Now, engine control the time flow. So we do not depend on libvirt freezing. And we make sure that we freeze the guest file system before we create this snapshot. Because at the point we create the Ceph snapshot, the VM is not writing to the snapshot. It will write to the next one. So we want to make the file system consistent, and only then create the snapshot. So we added the new API to VDSM. Freeze API that is using libvirt FS freeze, and to the snapshot API we added the frozen flag. So when we take a snapshot, we can tell you yourself if the VM is frozen or not. And finally, we added the tower API again using libvirt API. So now the flow is like this. Engine first freeze the VM, create this snapshot via Cinder, take the snapshot in VDSM, which may use, the VM may have Ceph disk and regular disk, or maybe you want to take memory snapshot or whatever. And when you finished, we tell the VM in VDSM. And when we are taking a snapshot without Ceph disk, we just tell VDSM, take a snapshot,
these tools and tools, and VDSM do the right thing. Any questions?
If you make the whole thing agnostic and do the reading and throwing in QA mode per se, you'd suffer from timeouts in the guest operating system, wouldn't you? Or didn't you?
Yes, but there is another way. You must use the guest agent for this.
Yeah, that's what you do now because of such implications I just mentioned. Or was there some other design flaw going down that path in order to avoid guest agent presence in all of the different guest operating systems?
If you open a guest agent, we won't have consistent snapshots. We cannot do anything about it. So if you want to access the snapshots, you have to install the guest agent. Or on Windows, you can use the VSS. This is the limitation of snapshots.
I can answer. The problem is that the guest doesn't pass as fast as something in memory, and yeah. It doesn't know that.
Right, I know. My idea was, and I presume that we have issues with that approach with respect to timeouts in the guest operating system, that you essentially freeze the QA as a central place, presuming that you could do the whole cycle quick enough that the guest doesn't hit a timeout, an IO timeout. Right? Of course, you wouldn't have the perfect, content because the guest would have data in memory still. But we probably suffer from the timeouts anyway, because you can't rely on the particular guest behaving, relying with respect to time. If you would do it quick enough, you could actually avoid all these guest agents, like I said. Essentially, your snapshot will contain the half-written content, and the snapshot will receive the rest. It might be read, but that's just an idea because I was afraid of the timeout implications anyway. If your switch takes too long, right? Right. Yeah. Syncing up front the links, right?
Yeah. So there are.
Okay, future directions. First, the missing feature that we don't have yet. This is not a complete feature. These are the most important things. Move disk. We do not support moving disk from Ceph to Ceph, from Ceph to another storage, or from another storage to Ceph. It should be impossible. I hope using libvd without involving mounting or stuff like this. Live storage migration, it's same like move this, but doing it live, more complicated. Here, hopefully, libvd support it to switch from regular disk to metro disk. If it does, we can do it. Disaster recovery, currently we in oVirt, we persist all the VMs in storage, but in Ceph we do not create the OVF store volumes, which we probably can do, but we don't know it now. And we cannot connect to Ceph storage domain and recover all the VMs from the storage domain, like we can in iSCSI or in FS or any other storage. Monitoring is an important point. In regular storage, we are doing a lot of monitoring on the part of the storage domain. The monitoring is not perfect probably, but we can we know what happens with this storage, and if the storage is not available, engines know not to try to start again on this storage. In Ceph, we don't have any monitoring, not on the host side, not on engine side. So everything is always up, creation will fail. Secret management. We want to do the secret management that I that you see before. It's too complex. We don't want to manage secret or host. What we want to actually do is just send the secret to the host that needs to run a VM or needs or you want to migrate a VM to this host. Define the secret temporarily on this host, start a VM or finish a migration. When we are done, delete the secret. All the management that we are doing is just a waste of time and effort. So hopefully this is something that we can do in the next version. Of course, migrating may be harder because we need to migrate the VM. We need to make sure that the same surveillance that the VM is using will work on this destination. So the secret that we should define should use the same UID, because this is the UID that the liberty survey contains, and this is what liberty we look for when we try to connect it to your network. Cinder. Cinder is having different views on storage. For example, it likes to decide for you what kind of storage you want. So if you want self-storage, Cinder may decide that why don't you take AVM storage or whatever storage or NFS. And we are not prepared to handle this. We are not Nova, we don't get from Cinder some storage and use it. We want exactly our storage, but Cinder will not let us configure it. So we must depend on the specific configuration, and we can work only with this specific configuration. So one idea was to provide our own Cinder and control this Cinder instance with our agent, so we can control the configuration, and we can bypass the Cinder different view of the world. And we can also hide the Cinder completely behind the engine UI, which is something that the customers really like. Simple UI and unified UI instead of this is one idea. I'm not sure that we are going to do it, because there is another idea. Why not we drop Cinder? Because Cinder is just a middleman. We don't need a middleman. We can use LibRBD. It's very easy to create volumes and snapshots and everything. Even it has Python bindings. It's really great. But the problem is that we want all the nice drivers that Cinder supports. So we'll have to think about this. And if we think a few years ahead, maybe we should drop traditional storage. It's so complex, hard to maintain, easy to break. So why do we need it? This storage is good because it can support floppy disk. We don't need any smartness on the server side, but we can use smart servers like Ceph. Or a lot of other smart servers. This is the direction that the world is going. Smart server, not floppy disk, so not sure that we will have this in 3 years. So, questions?
So, this Cinder service, where does it have? How many of those do you have?
What?
The Cinder service,
yes.
Where does it run? Where is it? How many of those you have in
Cinder? Something that you should deploy in your setup.
So
you can have
that. Doesn't matter yet?
What?
Often, like assume that you have already configured Cinder somewhere else, and that connects to it?
We have to install Cinder and whatever other services that the Cinder requires. Same like Ceph. You are responsible to install Cinder, to install Ceph, and we consume it, or we manage it. We don't install it. Like I said, server, I can not install dice in the server to all the fix.
So with open to Cinder, someone has to talk with this. You don't know what the configuration is, you don't know what the version is, and it's not notorious what the version of the configuration is. So we came up with the Cinder appliance idea, because Cinder payload are a person right now serving the version. That's supposed to make it easier than starting upon after the issue with Cinder.
So, asking from an assistant administrator point of view, are you thinking about making any feature for the automated snapshots, like schedule snapshots? No, in the traditional store.
Something that we can add on the engine side, I don't know.
I knew that it would be
done. Generally speaking, we actually had this idea a couple of years back. Back in the days, that's kind of different place in the ecosystem. Backup partners to do this orchestration, but yeah, it's not a bad feature to have out of the box. It's fine on our fields to that nature.
You can also do it yourself with the REST API, quite SDK.
Yeah, but I was asking like from inside the event board.
If you need such a beef, just write the script within the available groups. And when you have a good solution, maybe you can make it a feature. It's very easy to do stuff like this. Anything else? So we move on.
מה לגבי גיבויים? יש איזושהי... לא, אני כבר אתפוס לך בהרצאה הבאה.
Great. What?